All right, peace of Christ to all. Welcome everybody. Today we are broadcasting in the other channel. You know, I have right now three channels actually, and I'm broadcasting one of the older channels, so those who are there, they can join us. Today our topic is a normal topic Muslims always repeat, and Christians usually do not know really how to answer. Or let us say, they do not have the expertise on answering this topic. So what we will do today, we will show them how to answer Muslims regarding this issue, and not to depend on the Bible, because usually what Christians do, they right away jump into the Bible to answer. You know, Christians should learn that debating Muslims should not be based on the Bible. I know that many of you, they will say, oh, you know, the best way is to defend against Satan is to use the word of God. That is true and wrong in the same time, because the word of God is rejected by those people already. So you are talking to no one and nobody is listening, and simply you are talking to yourself. So why I wanna, even the Bible, he said, like, if people don't appreciate you, don't throw the words of God under the feet of the swine. So you have to be careful when you use the word of God and you present the word of God to who. Now, Muslims always, they say the following. I'm going to show you the video. Let us play a little bit of it so we can see how we can refute this argument very easy. Let us move a little bit.
The birth of Jesus is mentioned in the Quran and in the New Testament. In the Quran, the question is, how shall I have a son when no man hath touched me? The Quran replies, even so Allah creates what he wills. When he had decreed a plan, he but says to it, be, and it is.
This is what the Muslims say. You see, they make it wide and big. Allah, he says, if Allah, he wants something, he said it be, and it is. But this is a very stupid argument, and I will tell you why. Because the Quran say clearly that the similarity of Jesus is the same as Adam, and actually later I'm sure he will mention that to you in the video.
When you contrast that with the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verse 35, the answer that we're given in direct reference to this is, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Most High shall overshadow thee. The word in Greek is kaiho angelos apokritos auto apen hagion pneuma epi.
Okay, Abdul. You know, actually, this is why Muslims like those, they debate James White, but they will never dare to get close to me. Because people like James White, they, you know, they will never attack Islam really. They will do respond based on what he learned regarding the Bible, but he will not really, let us say, destroy Islam. So a Muslim debating someone like James White, he will not lose any, he will not lose anything. He is, James White will answer, but he did not really, let us say, hurt Islam. So when a Muslim says to us, the similarity of Jesus is the same as Adam, and then he mentioned another verse says, that if Allah, he wants something, he say be, and it was. Well, you know what? I challenge Muslims to show me one thing in their religion, one thing Allah, according to their religion, he said be, and it was. Especially if the Muslims agree that the Quran speak about Adam, that he is, you know, the same as Jesus. So how Allah, he created Adam first? According to the Quran, chapter 15, verse number 29, it says, I'm going to choose any translation for you, whatever you like, and you will see the following. When I have finished him, what finished mean? I mean, it means he designed him, like he made him like a statues, you know, as statues, and he made him from mud, and he made him look like a man, And then he furnished him in the look of a man. And then he breathed into him from my spirit. And then how this is Adam, he came to existence. So Allah did not say to Adam, be, and he was. Allah never created anything according to the Quran by saying be, and it was. Like what? The earth took him 7 days. Actually, some verses says 8 days. So what exactly Allah he created and it was by saying be? This is a false fiction. When a Muslim speak about this issue, simply he is being a fool. He is not even reading his book. And, you know, he is just going blind by a verse in the Quran saying the similarity of Jesus is the same as Adam. If we go and see the verses in the Quran, let us switch to Arabic. You will see in the all examples we have, all of them with no exception, there's nothing in the Quran to speak about Allah creating anything by saying be. Actually, Allah, he is the same as any creature. It takes him time to do things, and he is no exception from all the physical physics we have, like the physics of time. You see, all those verses mention about supposedly Isa. Now, if we go to the Quran as an example, chapter 3, verse number 45, we will see the following. Behold, the angels said, O Mary, Allah giveth thee glad tidings of a word from him. His name will be Christ Jesus. Actually, this is false translation. In the Quran, doesn't say will be. False fiction translation. It says his name, Christ Jesus. All right? And here, the funny, like this is why I say the Quran is a stupid book. Maybe some of you do not notice because you don't read deep. Imagine you say to someone, you say to Mary, you will have a son, his name is Jesus Christ, son of Mary. But she is Mary, you idiot. What do you mean his name will be Jesus Christ, son of Mary? You are telling her you will have a son, and you are telling her his name is going to be Jesus Christ, son of Mary? Like son of Mary is a name? You are telling her the name of her son, no problem. But what do you mean the son of Mary? Let it go, let it go. All right? So if you think about this here, you will notice that we have a problem in this issue. Here Mary is not a breadnet yet. Mary is not a breadnet. Mary is just receiving a news. It is nothing more than a news. And what is the news? A word from him. His name is Christ Jesus. So the Messiah himself is word from God. Then how you say that to me that the Messiah is the same as Adam? He said to him, be, and he was. What we see here, that the Messiah, he is the word. He was not created by a word. He is the word. And he is exist before his birth. This is why he have a name. This is why I say it. The verse here doesn't say will be. It's a fabrication of Muslims, because a smart Muslim will think about it. If I say the angels, they came to Mary and they said to her, you know, we have a great news for you, a word of God, his name is the Messiah. That means the Messiah already exists. And actually, to prove my point, if I change the translation, if I switch in a second, I will take different translation just to show you why I don't trust Muslim translation and why I wanna, you know, for sure I'm going to finish my translation for the Quran. If we switch to different translation, we showed you Yusuf Ali, we will go to Shakir. All right. you will see here the word will be does not exist. Do you see it? A word from him whose name, who is name. This means he exists already. Not will be. There's a huge difference. You know, when we talk about what it's called Holy Scriptures, I'm not saying the Quran is Holy Scriptures, but I'm saying at least it is for somebody. It's a Holy Scripture. So Muslim, they should be honest when they translate. But no, they cannot. There's a huge difference between he will be and he is. Will be, you are talking about the future. He is, it's mean he is exist right now. And this is exactly what the verse is saying. So the Messiah is the word of God, supposedly, according to the Quran. And his name, who is name, is the Messiah Isa. So he have a name already. He is a person already. And he is the word of God already. So how you say to me that Allah, he says, be and it was? Be, it was what? This is before his birth. They talk about Jesus as the same as the same as Adam, you know. But Jesus is not the same as Adam. Adam never been word of God. Adam never exists before his birth. I mean, before his creation. And Adam never have a name until he was exist, and then he was named. This is why I encourage people when they read any kind of book, anything, you know, when somebody want to say something to you, focus, you know, carefully. Don't just go by, you know, just like people, they when they read, they are just like drive it through. Fast food. You cannot do that if you want to really go deep in the knowledge. You have to be really focused, and you have to find the true meaning, and you have to go inside deep of the issue. If we go back to the Quran, I want you to remember this here. So this is a chapter 3, verse number 45. As you see, Jesus, his name is the Messiah before he was born. And that's fit with the Bible when Jesus said, before Abraham I am, which means I am exist before my birth. And this is what refute another argument the Muslims, they come to you with, they say, well, when Jesus was in the grave, where is the Trinity? Well, you Abdul, you forgot that the Trinity was exist before even Jesus is born. So where is the Trinity then? We didn't see him. We don't have Jesus with us. We don't see him physically. We don't see the visible image of God as Jesus. So the Trinity was not exist. No, the Trinity is exist. So Jesus in the, you know, the body of Jesus in the grave, that will not terminate one of the Trinity persons, because simply Jesus was not exist too as a person between us as a man, a visible image of him, when he was not born yet. So I hope you would take a note about this. Now, if we go to the Quran and show you the madness of the Quran author. Remember, this is chapter 3, verse number 45. We go to the verse where Allah, he compared between Jesus and Adam. All right? And then you will see that this doesn't make sense. Everything in the Quran doesn't make sense anyway. Like I never saw in the Quran anything makes sense. All right. Chapter 3, verse 59. All right? Chapter 3, verse 59. Actually, we are in the same chapter, but there's a few verses between them. So if we go to Shakir, it says, Surely the likeness of Isa, which means supposedly Jesus, is with Allah as the likeness of Adam. He created him from dust. Then he said to him, be, and he was. That's funny. This is not what the Quran is even saying. This is not even what the Quran is saying, because the Quran says that we fashion him. We just showed you the verse. We fashioned him and then we breathed into him, and he didn't say to him, be at all. He did not say, be. The word be here appear, but the word be there does not appear. It says we fashioned him and then we breathed into him and then he came to existence. Where is the be? Allah, he mixed the dust, he made mud. Allah, he fashioned, which means he made him look like a man from mud. And then Allah, he breathed into him. And then he come to life. This is what actually we see. If we go to the Quran, there's a verse in the Quran, actually. Most of people do not notice it because you have to have a strong knowledge, I mean, in the Quran, and able to notice what the topic there. So if you go to this this verse here, for some reason it's not coming. Let us see here. All right. Chapter 17, verse number 11. Chapter 17, verse number 11, speak about the creation of Adam. But you know, those who do not know, don't have knowledge, if you read it, you will not really notice there's anything there about Adam. Like, if you click at the translation, it says, and man, you know, he was hasty, he was ever hasty, he was a rush. Human being, he was a rush. A rush for what? What does that mean? What do you mean he was a rush? If you go to the interpretation, you will see that he was a rush because simply when Allah created him, let us go to the interpretation and read together. This is chapter 17, verse number 11. Take a note. This is Ibn Kathir website. Actually, it's chapter 17, sorry. Verse number 11. Here we go. وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا, and man invoke Allah for evil as he invoke Allah for good. And man is ever hasty. What does that mean exactly? Let me show you. I hope they have the full story here in the translated version of it. Because usually Muslim, they have a diet in their books. I have all the books of Ibn Kathir. If I show it to you how big it is, the volumes, and then you will see in English became very, very little books, you know. This is why I say there's a diet. For those who are asking me where I am in YouTube, I'm using now the old account, the account I used before the Arabian Prophet. Sorry. So if you are wondering where I am, I'm using the older account. All right, so let us see here what the story, and man is ever hasty. I apologize for the coughing, but sometimes you have to, you have no choice. By the way, guys, if you have a questions, you can ask in the site, in case you do not notice, there's an option where you can ask questions and I will be happy to answer you. And man is ever hasty. Salman al-Farisi and Ibn Abbas mentioned the story of Adam when he wanted to get up before the soul reached his feet. When his soul was breathed into him, It entered his body from his head downwards. When it reached his brain, he sneezed and said, Alhamdulillah. Praise be to Allah. And Allah said, May your Lord have mercy on you. All right, which is very stupid, by the way. Because if you are the Lord, how you say, may the Lord have mercy? Aren't you the Lord himself? Like, seriously, the one who made the Quran, the one who come with those stories, do he have a brain? If Allah is the one saying to him, mercy on you, why he saying, may the Lord have mercy on you? This is not a speech somebody will say he is God himself. This is somebody else saying that. But in here it says, Allah, he said to him, this is why I say, read carefully and you will see how stupid this religion is. So Allah said to him, may the Lord have mercy on you. O Adam, when it reached his eyes, he opened them. And when it reached his body and limbs, he started to stare at them in wonder. He wanted to get up before it reached his feet, but he could not. He said, O Lord, make it happen before the night comes. Uh-oh. I thought Allah, he say be and it's going to be. What we see here is not the same story. We don't see somebody saying be and it was. As you see, this is why the verse saying and the man, he was in a rush, he was in a hurry, he wanted to finish him fast. So here, what kind of insan wa ajula, speaking about Allah and Adam conversation together. Allah created Adam, creating Adam. It's taking him time. Adam is getting worried. The sunset is coming soon, and you did not finish me yet. And according to the hadith, Allah created Adam in a Friday. Took him the whole day of a Friday. So when Abdul, he come to us and say the Quran say Allah is the same as, you know, the creation of Jesus is the same as saying be. This is how easy it is. And then the verse says, as in chapter 17, verse number 11, says that Adam, he created very slowly. That is a very stupid statement. In the same time, it's a big contradiction. Allah, he breathed into Adam. Allah first, he made Adam, made mud. Then Allah, he fashioned the mud in the look of a man. And then Allah, he breathed into Adam. And look like the breathing is taking for long. It's like a downloading a file. To the point, you see here, that the breathing coming through step by step. It's not like one thing happened in a second. No. Adam is trying to, when the breath reached his brain, he sneezed. And he said, Alhamdulillah. You see, Adam, he right away, he know Allah, he know how to say or speak Arabic. And right away, he say, Alhamdulillah. And then Allah said to him, may Allah have mercy on you, Adam. When the breath reached into his spirit, his eyes, he opened his eyes. You see, step by step, first the brain. Second, the eyes. He opened them. And when it reached his body and the limbs, he started to stare at them in wonder, but still he can't stand up. You see? So now he step by step, first the brain, then the eyes, and then it's arriving to his limbs. He starts feeling them, but still he cannot stand up. And then, even after which reach to his limbs, still he cannot stand up, and he asks Allah, finish me. Which means he's not finished yet. Finish me before, make it happen before the nights come. That means that this was a long day. It can't be a few minutes. You know, otherwise, why Adam is worried? And here the story is very stupid too, because how Adam knows that the night will come if this is his first time in the earth? How the first man, you know, the first man who just created, he know that there is morning, there is night. What do you mean, finish me before the night come? How Adam knows the time? How he can measure the time? Did he saw a day before, or this is his first second in the creation? So the story simply presents for us a problems, and this is why Muslims, when they debate someone like James White, because James White, if he answer, he will start quoting from the Bible, he will, etc. At the same time, this guy, he never harmed Islam. And this is very important for Muslims when they debate. Muslims don't want to debate someone, he will harm Islam. They want to debate someone, he have no idea what Islam is about, and whatever he say is not going to be a problem for them. So we will debate you, as long you know nothing about Islam, you are good for us. As long you will not be tough on our religion, you are perfect. Even if you are able to defend yours, because at the end of the day, still you could not attack us, you are just defending. So Muslims, they love those who they defend, but they cannot attack. Because, like, you know, imagine you go in war, but the other party of the war, he signed an agreement with you that he will never cause you an injury. You know what I mean? You want to fight with me, but I promise you, if you fight with me, I will never cause you an injury. That's a wonderful war. So injury will happen only in your side, and in the best scenario, you will survive it. And this is exactly what Muslims do. So when a Muslim, he says to you, Jesus is the same as Adam, I hope you guys, you have an answer for this, and you know how to refute them and how to answer them. And there is tons of stories about, you know, like if we go to the books of Hadith, we will see that the story of Adam, it doesn't make sense at all, you know, and even the story of the creation. Like even sometimes the Muslims, they make fun of the Bible. They say, well, the scientists, they say the earth was created in millions of years, and your Bible says in 6 days. Our Quran doesn't say that. The fact it does says that. They say the word day in the Quran mean period. It doesn't really mean date, which is really false. And for sure we can prove that very easy, because you know Muhammad is a person who talk a lot, and when the fool talk, the fool make mistake and expose his followers. And that goes for both sides. I mean, the Muslims and Muhammad. The Muslims do not know their books, and Muhammad, he do not know our books. So both, they make mistakes when they talk about themselves or about us. So when a Muslim, he attack us, regarding the creation of the earth, for us, we know, we can find easy an answer for how God created the earth and the heaven, and you know, we can prove it, and we can say that, yes, you know what, in our Bible we have a proof where God, he says be and it was. Like as an example, in the book of Genesis, God said to the light, be, and it was. But you would never say in the, you would never find in the Quran anything was created by saying be and it was. I will show you another hadith here. Let me switch here. In this hadith here in front of us, let me show you in the front page. Here, I hope the page is clear. Guys, don't forget, you can ask me questions in the side. There's an option, you can it's called the Q&A. You can click in it and you can ask questions, and I will be happy to answer you. All right, so let me, I hope the text is clear. I will try to zoom in more. The Messenger of Allah, and again, this is the book of Riyad al-Salihin. We can find the hadith in many books, by the way, all right? The Messenger of Allah took hold in my hand and said, Allah exalted the glorious, created the earth in Saturday, and on Saturday, the mountains on Sunday, the mountains on Sunday, the trees on Monday, the things entirely in labor on Thursday and Tuesday. Actually, the evil, you know, he created the evil in Tuesday, light in Wednesday, and he spread out the animal of all kind on Thursday, and he created Adam in the afternoon of a Friday. Here he say, you know, he give more details saying, and it was the last hour of a Friday. I will go with this. Let's say it is the last hour of a Friday. It's an hour. It's not was. It wasn't. It wasn't B and it was. There's a huge difference between I say B and it was, and it take me an hour to do something. That is very, very slow B. Actually, here you will notice something. I don't know if you ever debate a Muslim who is usually a professional idiot, as most of them. By the way, I'm not calling names. I'm just describing them, my experience with them. A Muslim will come to you and you say, how in your Bible it says that God created the light in Wednesday? So the earth and everything was without light for all those days? They cannot survive. Well, they cannot survive. And you are against it. But it is in your book. But because the Abdul, he would have no education. The ignorant Abdul, as all of them, they do not know what their books is teaching. So they throw rocks at you when the fact what they are attacking is exist in their book. They forgot their God is even stealing from us his stories. So I hope here you have an answer. If somebody says to you ever, if he's a Muslim Abdul, he says to you, you know what? How the Bible speak about the creating the light in the fourth day, in Wednesday. We'll tell him this is in your book too, and this is what your prophet agree upon. So when a Muslim says in our book, it doesn't say really a day. It doesn't say a day. What do you mean it doesn't say a day? It say a day, and this is why it says here that the Friday and it was in the last hour. Do you see it? Like you will hear Zakir Naik and did that and those liars who have no education whatsoever about Islam. This is why I don't consider those people are scholars. You see, I saw a video. It was Brother Sam Shamoon and David Wood. And they were talking about who is the highest scholar right now exists, as we know. They mentioned Shabir Ali. Shabir Ali is a potato. You know Shabir Ali? Honest to God, if Shabir Ali debate me, I will make him smash potato before even he know it. None of those people are scholars. And this is why they will not even get close to me. This is why ABN TV, they contacted every one of them. And each time they know who is going to debate them, they run away. The answer always exists in Islamic books. Don't debate Muslims refuting them from your book. You are wasting your time. Because as long as you are doing that, you are not hurting Islam. And this is the most important thing for a Muslim. He debate you, he know he will lose nothing because you are not hurting Islam. You know, you want to tell him the Bible says that, so. I don't believe in your Bible, okay. But you are not touching Islam. And this is the important for them. So we need to learn that when we debate a Muslim, we have always to consider that in our debate, the most important thing is demolishing Islam, not only refuting Islam. Especially if I'm refuting from my book, because when I refute from my book, which is the Gospel or the Old Testament, I did nothing really except just giving an answer. But when I use their books, then, what he can say? What a Muslim can say? What a Muslim can answer? Nothing. He will be in trouble. He will be looking around his feet, trying to find a solution. trying to get you know, get rid of the problem he created to himself. How I can get rid of this, what I did to myself. But as long as I am just refuting from the Bible, I am saying nothing specifically. You know, I'm just, I'm giving him an answer from a book, which is at the end of the day, he said, well, you know what, this is a book, is a fabricated, we don't believe it anyway, and you are wasting your time and our time, and you did nothing. So you speak to them for 4 hours, speaking about your gospel, you did nothing. And this is why Muslims, they debate and they prefer to debate someone. He don't mention their book when he debate them, because that will give them, like, let us say, an agreement, as I said, that I can wound you, but you cannot wound me. I can throw rocks at you, but you are not allowed to throw rocks at me. Because as long as you are not throwing rocks, then there is no reality here. Until now, I see no questions from anyone. I'm not sure why, because what I know that questions should be. Oh, I see the question. Sorry, I need to switch. I'm the one who did not switch. I would be very thankful if you could answer the question. Okay, what is the question? If Adam could read Arabic, why Muhammad could not read when the angel asked him? Well, you know what? Here we cannot say Adam he read Arabic. Adam he speak Arabic. There's no way it says Adam he read, right? So we have to be truthful here. It doesn't say in that statement that Adam he read Arabic. Adam he speak Arabic. Correct? I hope you understand. Then another question. I want to you everything you had done. I'm not sure what the brother here is trying. I think he's just praying for me. What about Eve? What about Eve? If you guys can make the question more clear, so I will be happy to answer. Is it true that the story of Isa or whatever, call him, are stolen from false and all the Christians? Okay, you know, there is false books. There is false books which is not approved in Christianity. Like, you know, there is many Bibles, you know, there exist, but those are rejected and they are not accepted, right? So you will see many of those stories. This is coming from those books, all right? But the question here, if Muhammad is a person who is getting his information from God, how come he is getting those his stories from stories which is, it doesn't make sense even for the Christians? And not only this, it's even wonderful for the Christians if they accept it. Let me tell you why. As an example, Christians, they want to prove to you that Jesus is God. All right? So it is for the benefit of the Christians to keep a verse like the one that says that Jesus created from the mud the bird. Correct? In order to prove to you that Jesus is a creator, it's for my benefit as a Christian to keep that verse in my book. So why I'm taking it off? It doesn't make sense. Additional to this, why Muhammad is telling us in his Quran that Jesus can create from the mud the bird if you want to convince us that Jesus is just a prophet? You know what I mean? Additional to this, why even Allah is giving Jesus the ability of creation if he just want him to be a prophet? You know what I mean? if I want you to be a prophet, I will provide you with the tools. Let us say God wanted me to be a prophet. God will give me the ability to deliver my message. What a prophet he need in order to deliver his message? To be wise, to be truthful, to be brave, support him with some miracles, no problem. But creating from the mud, the bird, this is not just a miracle. This is about creation. And actually, this is the a contradiction for the Quran, because the Quran says, you know, the Quran gives us the rules of who we worship. Let me show you. If we go in the Quran, let me switch here the screen so you can see with me what I'm going to read for you. If you go to chapter 7, verse number 191, chapter 7, verse 191. In Islam, shirk is associating the name of God with other names, which means worshiping more than one God, one more additional to the true God, supposedly. So, if we go here, this is Yusuf Ali translation. It says, do they indeed ascribe to him partners, things that can create nothing? Read with me, please. And I want you to use your intelligence. I would like to see people in the text, in the chat there, to tell me, what do you think about this verse? Anybody can tell me? Anybody can tell me, really, what do you think about this verse? Do they indeed ascribe to him as partners, things that can create nothing? Do you notice what the problem here? There's a big problem. I'm not sure if you notice with me what the problem. Let us see here how deep we are in the thinking. Think with me. Who noticed the problem, please? Tell me. What the verse in the front of us is saying, if you ascribe to him someone he create, there's no problem. But you ascribe to him, which means you associate with him, someone he create nothing, this is a problem. All right? This is the rules is made by Allah himself. Let us think about it. If you associate with God another one, but he create, it's okay. But the Quran says to us that Jesus, he can create. But are they themselves created? So there is two conditions here. We see like two of them. They can create, and they themselves are created, which means if they cannot create and they are themselves created, it means they are false. Now, in the case of Jesus, how you can be created and you are a creator? That's impossible. Because in order to be creator, it means you are exist already, and you are the first creator. Because you are created, this means somebody else created you, and the creator is the only one who can create. And the proof, he created you too. So in order to be the creator, you have to be the only creator. There's no two creators, there's no three creators. We don't, you know, in Christianity, we don't have four or five creators. We have only one. That's why the Bible says clearly that everything created for him and by him. Everything created for him and by him. Him who? Him Jesus. So when we say everything created by him, and for him. And we say that this is Jesus. We are confirming that Jesus is the creator. The Muslims, because of their foolishness, they think that Jesus exists when he was born. But we showed you from the Quran that Jesus, even in the Quran, Jesus exists before he's born. Because the angels, they came to Mary and they said to her, we came to announce to you the great news. That Jesus is the Word of God. His name is Jesus. There is a Word of God. The Word of God exists before what, you know, if we ask the Muslims what Jesus was before he was before his birth, what Jesus was, they will say he was the Word of God. All right? Okay. So he was the Word, and then he became the man. Well, isn't it, this is what the Bible says in John chapter 1, verse number 1 and verse 14? In the beginning it was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word is the God. And then the Word became a man, became a flesh. If you go to chapter 3, verse number 47, I will go back a little bit. We will see here the following. I'm going to read the questions in a second, please. If you have a question, please ask me. All right, don't hesitate. We are here to help each other and help, because later people, they can see, I think, those questions. And make him an apostle to the children of Israel. All right. Just wait, let us go back for the 47, sorry. She said, my Lord, when I shall be born a son, and nobody touched me. This is supposed to be Mary saying that. Actually, if you see here the story, you will see something fishy in the story. I don't know if you guys, if you notice. The one who came to Mary is the angels. Read with me verse number 45. When the angels said, O Maryam, surely Allah gives you good news with a word from him. Who his name is the Messiah. So the Messiah, his name is the Messiah before he was born. You don't give a name for someone who doesn't exist yet. You should say, and you will name him, etc. But what the Quran is saying, his name. At that moment, Jesus was what? He was the Word of God. The Word of God who have a name of a person. Do you notice with me? He is the Word of God, but yet he have a name of a person, which means he is a person. Even though he was the Word of God, for the Word of God is God. You know, if we ask Muslims, ask this question for Muslims, and see how in trouble they will be. Tell them, is the Word of God created? Is the Word of God created? They will say no way. Actually, I can show you stories of people being slaughtered in Islam for just saying the Word of Allah is created. You cannot say that. The Muslim, the second he say the Word of Allah is created, he is apostate. And I can show you. Approve of what I'm saying. If you look with me here, let us, I will share with you in the screen. Actually, it's in the front of you already. The Quran is the Word of Allah, may be exalted and not created. Do you see it? Do you see it, guys? It says that, right? So the word of Allah is not created. But you just told me that Jesus is the word of God. You know what I mean? Yeah, we will talk about the spirit later, but let's finish first. Somebody is asking, doesn't even it says he was the word of God and he is called the spirit of God as well? Yes, but I'm just going step by step. So if you are looking with me at the screen, you will see that the word of God, the word of God is not created. And you can read the whole page actually. You know, I'm not sure if I can post the link for you in there. There is no option for me to post, just to answer. Anyway, you will see that the whole article there is to prove to you that the word of God is not created. All right, the Quran as an example, the Quran is the word of God, may he be exalted, etc., and it is not created. What the problem with saying the word of God is created? I challenge the Muslim to tell me why. What is the logic of saying, of rejecting, to accept that the word of God is created? They will say to you, the word of God is eternal. Okay, well, you know what? You Muslims, supposedly, you will be created and you will stay in heaven for eternity. That will not change anything. Allah can speak and his word can be eternal. From the second they came to existence, they are going to be eternal. What the problem here? I don't see a problem. But they will say that the word of God is part of his attributes. Look carefully. The word of God is part of his attribute. You see? When we say the word of God is part of his attribute, and it's mean it exists from the beginning, it's mean it exists since Allah is exist, it's mean it exists always. That's mean God and his word is one, because they exist together, they've never been separated, and it's not created. And this is what you say about your God. You say Allah is not created, Allah is always exist, and Allah is not separated. So when a Muslim, he speak about Allah as always exists, eternal, and the word of God is always eternal, then we will come with another question. Is Allah and his word are two kind of identity, or it's one identity? Is it one? Are we following, guys? That will cause the Muslim big problem. Because if the Muslim, they say, they are two separated things, but both are eternal. Now we have two gods. You know what I mean? If the word of God is separated from Allah, and the word of Allah is eternal, and Allah is eternal, so now we have two eternal. Who they are not created. So the Muslim, they will find themselves under a very hard dilemma, and they do not know how to get away from it. Actually, this is why this topic, actually, if you wanna make a Muslim dizzy, okay, if you wanna see the birds going around the head of a Muslim, Abdul, asking this question. Seriously. You want the birds coming around his head, and he's getting dizzy and he fell in the ground, just ask him the question, is the Quran created? He will say no. Well, is the Quran, is the word of Allah, is exist with Allah? He will say yes. Is it eternal? Yes. Is it exist before Allah, he said them? He have to say yes. Because if he say they are exist after Allah, he said them, it's mean they are created. And as long now we have two things are not created and two things are eternal, so we have the first Allah and the second Allah. In the same time here, this is not a problem for the Christians. Why we don't have a problem to say the word of God is eternal and it's not a problem? Anyone in text can help me and tell me why? Why is it a problem? Because the Bible says clearly that the word of God and God is one. The Muslim do not believe that the word of Allah and Allah is one. And that is a big problem. Are we following, guys? This religion, it is a kind of a hitman who wanna practice, let us say, throwing knives at his own self. So Jesus, the Word of God, he exists before he was born, and that means his birth have nothing to do with his existence, for he was always exist. And as you see, the Muslim themselves, they admit that the word of God is not created. All right, additional to this, as long as the Muslims, they are, you know, they are, the whole purpose, by the way, Muslims, they do is to make Jesus, you know, like, to make him look like a normal man, right? The whole point is to downgrade the value of Jesus. And this is telling us what Islam is about. Because if Islam is really a religion, not a religion of Antichrist, why you try to downgrade Christ? They try to elevate Muhammad over Christ. And the funny, you know, the one of the funny things of the Quran, you will see the Quran says that Allah, he never favor any prophet upon any other prophet. I don't know if you know that, right? The Quran says Allah never favor any prophet upon any prophet. But if you go and read, you will see that yes, Allah did favor prophet upon prophets. What are you talking about? Actually, if we make a search, we can go back here. Huh? Let's switch to Arabic. Let me show you. Okay, this search is showing me all the words. I want to go specifically here. This is what I do for fast finding, you know, because this website have a problem to like to open chapter right away by the number. By the way, the verses you see in front of you, all of them, they confirm that the Jews are in favor upon other people, which is very weird, right? Like in here, chapter 2, verse 122, it says that Allah, he favored the Jews upon all mankind. Upon all mankind. Then the question will be, so at that time you are saying to me, there's no plan for the Arab? You know? That is a question to think about, right? Read with me here. This is a chapter 2, verse number 253. Those messengers we endowed with a gift, some above others. All right. So according to this verse, Allah, he favor messengers upon messengers. You can change the translation if you don't like it, you know. We have made some of those apostles to excel the others among them. Now, you know what? If we go this, if you read how Allah He excelled apostle upon each, some of them they spoke to Allah. Some of them He exalted by many degrees, like ranks. Some of them gave a clear miracles, like Isa, the son of Maryam. So, okay, if we go by this, according to this, Muhammad, it should be in the last of the list, because the one who speak to Allah, the one who have miracles, is the high rank. Well, where is Muhammad here? Muhammad never spoke to Allah. Muhammad never had miracles. The only thing Muhammad he have, he imagined himself having sex, but in fact he never did. The only thing Muhammad he have, he was bewitched. The only thing Muhammad he have, he have the most weak, excuse my language, weak penis, and he invoked Allah. He sent him a dish of shish kebab, he ate it, and he got the power of 40 men. So where is the rank of Muhammad? Muhammad should be not exist in any rank there. He had no prophecy, he had no miracles, he never spoke to his God, he never heard his God never inspired him. Muhammad is the only prophet, according to the Quran, who receive messages by delivery, not from his God. A pizza guy, his name is, nobody knows, they call him Jibreel. He knocked at the door, Muhammad, he opened the door, there's no door anyway. And what you have, I have Quran for you. Right? In different verse, you will see Muhammad. You will see the Quran saying clearly that yes, Allah, He favor, you know, He don't favor messengers upon messengers. You know, because this is the book of contradiction. Somebody asked me about Jesus, and He is the Spirit of God. Let us go there. Okay. I was focusing actually for me in the topic where it says that Jesus, He is the same as Adam. Allah, He says to him, be, and it was. And we prove to you that this does not exist. This is false, because simply the Quran itself says the opposite. Allah never created Adam by saying be. Therefore, the compare between Adam and Jesus is stupid. If you go here in chapter 2, verse number 253, you will see it says that Jesus, He was supported by the Holy Spirit. وَأَيَّدْنَاهُ بِرُوحِ الْقُدُسِ. And we armed him by the Holy Spirit, or we supported him by the Holy Spirit. Question: why Allah did not say the same about Muhammad? Why Allah in the Quran doesn't say, and we armed Muhammad by the Holy Spirit? Never. In chapter 4, verse number 171, as we see in the front of us, it says the following: that Jesus is the Word of God, and He is a spirit proceeding from Him. Proceeding from who? From Allah. And actually, this verse, always I use it to prove the Trinity for those who do not know. If you read with me here, you will notice the Trinity there. You see, the same verse denying the Trinity. The same verse says, say no Trinity. All right? You see it? Say not Trinity. The same verse, it says, say not to Trinity. I can prove the same verse, I can prove the Trinity. And let me show you how. Oh, people of the book, commit no excuse in your religion, nor say Allah aught but the truth. Christ Jesus, son of Mary, was this is between the two brackets does not exist. So we will skip it. This is why it's between two brackets. It's additional, does not exist. Jesus, the son of Mary, actually, there's no Jesus there. There's a Isa. Isa, the son of Mary, was a messenger of Allah and his word. So he is what? Messenger. Take note, please. He is the messenger. This is number one, which means what? He's a man. By the way, the messenger can be an angel too, right? So in this case, Jesus came to us as a man. He did not came to us as an angel. He is a man. So a messenger of Allah, and he is his word. So Jesus is a messenger and a word. What does that mean? This word is sent down in Mary. What does that mean? That mean what Mary she carried, it was a word. Do you see it? What Allah sent to Mary, his word. What Mary she carried, the word of Allah. Then the word of Allah became a man. You see it? And then in different verses says that Allah, he breathed into Maryam's vagina, which is very shameful to say, very disgusting to say. However, here, if you think about it, Jesus is the messenger and he is the word, which means he is the messenger and the message. And that explained why in Islam you don't see a story where Jibreel is delivering gospel to Jesus. You will never see a story where the angel Jibreel is squeezing Isa to teach him how to read and to tell him read in the name of Allah. You don't see that. You will see Jesus, he spoke when he was in the cradle, according to the Quran. The only way to explain that is because Jesus is the messenger and the message, for he is the word of God. Therefore, he does not need to be taught the word of God, for he is the word of God. Now we go to the issue of the spirit. Jesus being the spirit of God. So Jesus, the messenger, the word, and he is a spirit proceeding from him. Proceeding from who? From Allah. Well, isn't it? This is the Trinity. He is a spirit which is connected to God, which means the spirit of Jesus is the same spirit of God. It's always connected to him and it's proceeding from him. You see, my spirit is not proceeding from God. God, he created Adam and Eve, and he gave them the ability to recreate, to reproduce. So Adam and Eve, they are the first product of God, of a creation. However, like generally speaking, we say we are the creation of God. But in fact, I am the creation of my parents. Because God, he gave Adam and Eve the ability to produce through sex. So we are the creation of God. In the same time, God did not create me directly. He created my grandfather and mother, and from them I came. So the creation of God is was the first man, for first two animals, first trees, first etc., and the rest is just a reproduction. God is not creating us one by one. At the end of the day, you know, at the end of the day, yes, we are all a creation of God, but that if we go to the real meaning of a creation, but in fact we are just a reproduction of Adam and Eve. So Jesus is the word of God. Jesus is the spirit of God. Jesus is the messenger of God. That is exactly what the Bible says. Jesus is the messenger as a man who came to us, the visible image of God. The word of God became a man, and the word of God spoke, and the word of God came with the spirit of God. So the verse in front of us actually confirming the Trinity. When in the funny thing about it, the same verse is denying the Trinity is the same verse we can use it to prove the Trinity. Hacks saying, doesn't the verse 4:171 say not a tree? Does it mean different than a Trinity? No, no, actually it says no Trinity. It's in front of you. It means there's no Trinity. But Trinity in Islam, by the way, it's not what Trinity we have. Trinity in Islam is Mary, Allah, and Jesus. All right? Mary and Allah and Jesus. Trinity in Islam is not the Trinity, you know, which is in the gospel, which is the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. So Trinity in Islam, when we speak about Trinity in Islam, we are speaking about a serious error, which is proving Islam to be a false religion. For the one who made the Quran, he cannot even recognize, or he have no knowledge what the Trinity is. If we go to the Quran, you know, the Quran is a book of fictions, and actually, you know, I'm glad that this book is full of mistakes, because that will make it easier for those who they are seeking the truth to find that this is cannot be from God, because a God who do not know really what the Christians believe in, this is a fabricated God. You know what kind of God he do not know. What Christianity is teaching and what Trinity is about, you know, obviously someone, he is ignorant, trying to teach people about God, but he do not know how to do it, or trying to claim that he know Christianity and he want to debate the Christians, but he do not know how to do it. So if we go to the Quran here, let us say this verse. If you read with me here, this is chapter 5, verse 116. And when Allah says, O son of Maryam, did you say to men, take me and my mother for two God beside Allah? Do you see it? So what is a Trinity according to Islam that we Christians teach? What the Christians believe according to this? That we believe that Jesus and Mary and Allah is God. Now somebody will say to me, maybe he mean the Catholic. No, the Catholic do not believe in this. Don't fool yourself. The Catholic believe in the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and none of the Catholic believe that Mary is a divine and part of the Trinity. All right? Mary, for all of us as a Christians, we believe she is favored by God. By God, she is elevated over all women. But at the end of the day, she is a woman like every woman. This is why Jesus, he said to her, you know, he spoke to her in the Bible twice, and he never said to her, mother. He said to her, woman, what do you want from me, woman? So none of the Christians believe that Mary is part of the Trinity, and none of the Christians believe in Allah anyway. So the Trinity here have many mistakes. Number one, Allah. Allah is not part of the Trinity. For our God, regardless of his name, he is the Father. Is Allah the Father? Allah have no sons, and he is not the Father, so he cannot be the one to be meant in the Trinity. Number two, Mary. Number three, Isa saying, or Allah is accusing Isa, did you say, now if you think about it, the verse here, it says that Isa said to Allah, well, aren't you the one who knows everything? So what's the point of this question? In other way, Isa saying to Allah, are you being stupid now? Are you playing games with me, being silly? Why you are silly? Seriously, why you are silly? Aren't you the one who knows everything I do? So why you're asking me? What the point of this conversation? Did you say to your people to worship me? So it's a stupid accusation, have no point. So we need to remember that Muslims have a wrong trinity, and that because they have the wrong, let's say, the false teacher who do not know anything. A Hindu guy, he know more than Allah about the trinity of Christianity. Let us see another questions here. Sound like Satan making equipment. Okay. All right. When I'm trying to read the question to see if there's something I can answer. I just see comments. The Quran, male ones, I'm not sure if I'm saying your name wrong or right, sorry. The Quran, Allah words, and the eternal tablet are all not created. Isn't it that three divine things, Allah, not alone as deity? This is what I said in the beginning. You know, remember guys, I said if we ask the Muslim, is the Quran created, right? Is the Quran created? Now the tablet, by the way, that will raise, like, this is a smart question actually. This question he gave us, this is a very smart question. What about the tablet? Because Allah, he wrote his words in the tablet. All right, the Quran says fi lawhin mahfuz, lawhun mahfuz, which means a protected tablet, like Galaxy, you know, Galaxy, Samsung Galaxy. So Allah, he have a protected tablet, and he wrote his words in it, and he put it all the way in heaven. Actually, he put it between the eyes of an angel. His name is Israfil. So if we go here, chapter 85, verse number 22. Chapter 85, verse number 82. Allah, he preserved his words in a tablet. All right, you see it inscribed in Allah in a Lawh al-Mahfuz, which is preserved tablet. Now here, actually, this topic here will raise a funny funny argument. Guys, you as a human, you have a tablet, you have a notebook, you have a memory book, like, you know, in your phone you have you add my number, your family number, etc., for a reason, because simply you have a short memory, right? But God writing his words, it doesn't make sense. I mean, if he's writing it to give it to me, I understand. So because I am a human, I am not perfect, I will not remember, I might miss. So he write it for me. As an example, God, he gave Moses written tablet for him, but this was given to Moses, not for God to keep it with him. So the question here, why Allah have a tablet even with him? You know what I mean? Why Allah, he need a tablet? I am a man who will forget. Actually, we forget always, all of us, you know, this is normal to happen. So I need to write things down, and this is why books is written. If the word of Allah is eternal, and I write it for me, because not because the word is not eternal, but because I am not eternal, so I write the words. Like, you know, the Bible is written for a very simple reason. As an example, when John, he write the Bible, not because the word of God is not eternal, but because he is not eternal. So in order to carry on the word for the coming generation to study it, the word is there. It's not going to die. But how I'm going to have it? How I'm going to read it? Me as a human, I cannot hear the wind. I cannot hear the words that's been said before. For God, this is possible. For me, it's not. So in order to keep those words exist for me, in order to read it as a human, we write it in a book so we can carry on from generation to generation. Now, Allah writing a book for himself, why? I challenge any Muslim to tell me why. Give me a reason. Actually, this is remind me of a hadith which is very funny, where Allah, the first thing he created, it was a pen. The first thing Allah he created is the pen. Let me show you the hadith. And that will raise another question. Here we go. It says here, I'll read it in Arabic and in English. إن أول ما خلق الله القلم فقال له أكتب فجر بما هو كائن إلى الأبد. The first thing Allah he created, it was the pen. All right. I heard the Messenger of Allah saying, verily, the first of what Allah created was the pen. He said to it, write, so it wrote what will be forever. Hold on. Anyone here notice with me what, where is the stupid mistake here? I will wait for a minute. I'm waiting for your answer, guys. What do you think the stupid mistake Muhammad he made here? Anyone knows? What is the problem with this? I want to see who is the smartest here. This is why I say to you, learn how to read carefully and how to think deeply. What is the problem? Nobody want to tell me? I will give you a hint. Isn't it the word of Allah, not the created? Correct? We showed you the proofs and the reference according to Islamic scriptures that the word of Allah is not the created. Okay, well, according to this, the first thing Allah he created, it was a pen. To do what? To write what? When a pen write, what the pen will write? The pen will write words, right? The pen, focus with me on the topic, guys. Don't ask about something else now. The pen will write words, and then if the pen will write words, this means the words does not exist yet. This means the tablet is not eternal, because the tablet is exist after the word exists. Are you following with me? You know what I'm saying? Is the tablet of Allah is exist since the beginning? If the Muslim, they will say no, this is mean the word of Allah isn't exist since the beginning. According to this, the word of Allah is exist after the pen, not before the pen. For Allah at that point, he did not say the words yet. So you notice how a simple story can expose Islam. That's why it's very important to have, you know, to collect reference, to connect the dots together. You know, this religion is the same as chain, and the chain have many rings, and the more rings you have, the more long the chain you will have and more useful will be. This is why having reference is very important. All right? Now, Muhammad being possessed by Satan, this is a different topic. We're going to talk about it. Now, we want to focus about this now. You know, we can make a different topic for it. So, anyone have a question about the topic? Here we go. We have a pen, and it is the first to be created. And it's very funny. Allah, He created for himself a pen, and Allah, He write for Himself a tablet, the lonely Allah. The lonely God. Any Abdul? If you are a Muslim Abdul and you want to give me a question here, feel free. All right, don't be shy. I feel for you. It's not your fault to be a Muslim, it's your fault to stay a Muslim. All right. And you know the story here actually about the preserved tablet can come with another problem, big problem, which is the abrogation. All of us, we know that there's abrogated verses in the Quran, right? So when Allah, He abrogated verses in the Quran, do He abrogated verses in the preserved tablet? When Allah, He caused the Quran to be forgotten. You remember the Quran? Allah says, any verse I cause to abrogate or cause to be forgotten, I will give something similar or better. When Allah, He caused a verse to be forgotten. Allah going to cause the verse to be forgotten in the preserved tablet too? Like, is Allah going to do update? You see it? Whatever verse of revelation, actually this is between the two brackets, not there, forget. Do we abrogate or cause to be forgotten? So when Allah, He caused a verse to be forgotten, is He going to abrogate His tablet, the preserved one? If He does, it's meaning this is not a preserved. You're changing it. A preserved is something you don't touch. It's preserved as it is. The second you update and you upgrade, it's mean you are not preserving it. Correct? When I say to you that what I say to you is preserved, or what I gave you is did you preserve it? Or the word preserved is about keeping it as it is without any change. So what the verse here is saying, that Allah caused verses to be forgotten. And now, if Allah did not change the preserved tablet, which means did not update His tablet, now we will have two different Quran. We have the one which is preserved without abrogation, and we have the one which is preserved, which is not preserved, which is the Quran, and which come with abrogation. And they are not the same, they don't match. Any question here? Anyone have a question? So simply, you know, every story we see in the Quran can lead into another problem. And my experience with the Quran, that this is a religion of a problem. Everything in this religion is a problem. And Muslims' argument is the most stupid argument. But the issue is, are we capable of answering by knowledge and we know how to answer, or we are going just to line up words as those people they do? They start quoting from the Bible and the Old Testament and New Testament, trying to prove their point, wasting their time. I don't waste my time. You see, the Word of God for me have a very high value, to the point I am not willing to throw it under the feet of the Muslims. Because you throw the words of God, and you know, to them, they will put it in their foot and their feet, and they will step on it. So we should avoid doing that. We should fight this religion by itself. Like, do you know how scientists fight poison by poison? You know that, right? The vaccine for poison is poison. The vaccine of viruses is viruses. So the best way to fight a disease is to fight it by its own kind. You know what I mean? You don't, you know, this is the best way to fight anything, is to fight it by its own. You see, let me show you how Satan works. Satan, he fights you by your own children's, by your own people. You know, Satan, he will deceive people to fight you. Satan himself, he don't fight you. Satan, he will not come to you and he have a gun in his hand. I cannot give you the hadith. I don't know which hadith you are talking about. Which one you want? About Allah, he created the earth and the heaven in 6 days? Or about Adam? Someone is saying how you can give us the hadith. Maybe later, after I finish the video, maybe I can pause it there. All right. However, you see, guys, you can find it yourself. You can freeze the video later, all right, when it's loaded in YouTube, and you can type exactly, like type one sentence exactly as it is, it shows on the screen, and you will find the hadith right away. You know what I mean? Always to find any reference I give you, especially it's in English, so you have no problem. It's in Arabic, I understand, you will not be able to find it by yourself. Just to freeze the screen and type one sentence of the hadith exactly as it is in Google, and you will get it right away. All right? Yeah, this is what I'm saying. Like, you know, you fight virus by a virus. You train your body to fight the virus. And this is exactly what I'm doing with you. I'm teaching you about the virus, so you will have the vaccine against the virus. The problem is, most of the Christians, they've never been exposed to the disease of Islam. They've never been exposed to the virus of Islam. So you can get sick easy because you are not aware of it. Your body never been exposed to it, and you know, you don't have the enough immune system to, you know, especially if you are not really even occupied with a strong faith of your own. So you don't have a strong knowledge of your book. You don't have a strong knowledge of the meaning. You don't have a strong faith. And then the Muslims, they will hunt you down. This is what they do to your children. The Muslims, they have association in every university. And your child will go there, and they will trap him. Trust me, they have a network, a very, very strong network. You will not see a Christian network in schools. Muslims are networking people. They are working like as if they are in a nest. So your child go to school, he have no idea what this religion is about. They will trap him. Actually, if you go right now and see most of those people who joined terrorism and those most of those who did attacks in the West, they are convert. Most of them, they are not even Arab. They are not born from a Muslim family. So Islam will fight you by your own children. This is why what we do is extremely important. All right? And this is why we wish one day we will be able to have a TV station. We will be able to have to be on the more radio stations. But, you know, sadly, nobody really care. You know, nobody care. We are not getting really the help of Christians to be in TV stations. Nobody contact us. Like, you know, I will be next month. I will be in ABN. But, you know, ABN is a... they are not really that much professional, and they have mistakes they do, and I agree, because you know they keep asking me to come, and you know I feel they need me, so I will be with them next month. They have the marathon, the one they do always. So I told them the best I can do, if you can help me, get me some Muslim to debate me. So they will see if they can get me some Abdul, someone he is a brave. He is willing to commit suicide. All right. Any question? Yeah, they try. You know, don't look at somebody, a child who was converted to Islam, and say this will not happen to me. You see, you have to be careful. You always to consider that risk might come to you. So what do you do? You teach your children. I have thousands of videos for free. For free, it doesn't cost you a penny. Like right now, I am with you. You know what you spend to be here? Nothing. In order to learn anywhere, you have to go and pay for semesters. Like, you know, I look around to see if I can do PhD degree. It's extremely expensive. It's going to cost you at least 50,000, 55,000, something like this. Some schools like that, they say that cheaper, like 45. 3 years of work, $45,000 at least. And this is not including like going to rent the accommodation and books. No. This is just tuition. So you finish the PhD, you spend more than $100,000 to earn a piece of paper, all right? And this is why, actually, you know, I can't afford it to do that, even though I do not need a degree. But obviously, these days, people, they consider you more if you have a degree, if you have a paper that says PhD. People, they will invite someone like Shabir Ali, because simply he is a Dr. Shabir Ali right now. And someone like James White, because he's Dr. James White. So adding the title doctor in front of your name, people will make you, or they will believe that you are something. But in reality, those degrees have no value. Especially if you are talking about degrees in Islam, and you know, you take in the USA, who is the one who will be your teacher? Like Shabir Ali, he have a PhD in Islam. Who is the one who was in charge of Shabir Ali to give him the PhD? I guarantee you, he know nothing about Islam. So how he can give him a PhD? And if he's a Muslim like Shabir Ali, he will give it to him even without any examination. Muslims, they sponsor each other. He will never let him down. Right? Let us see if there is more questions here. All right. Actually, I tried. You know, I tried really to register for a PhD, because that can improve my, my mission, not my knowledge. I do not need a PhD for my knowledge. You know, mine PhD for me in Islam is going to be easier than cooking a rice, right? I do not need to study for it. I do not need to prepare for it. I do not need an exam for it. You know, it's nothing for me. It's just a degree. And as I said, people, they think that degree will make you more knowledgeable. Degree is a key for a profession, which means if you want to get a job, career, etc. But sadly, even churches, they consider you something if you have a PhD. It doesn't matter. Actually, I saw them sometime. They invite someone because he have a PhD to make a lecture about something have nothing to do with his PhD. You know what I'm saying? It's not even his field. Just because he have a PhD, he's a doctor. So whatever the doctor he says, he must be, he's a doctor, you know? Right? So doctor know better. And here we go. James White, he have a degree in Islam. And look how much, garbage he say when he speak about Islam. Actually, I wish that James White will accept to debate me about Islam. That would be a very funny debate. You know, isn't it funny that someone, he have a PhD in the Bible, churches, they invite him to teach about Islam? You know what I mean? This person, he have a PhD on the Bible. So what made him a scholar in Islam? Right? But this is how it is today. Anyway, if any of you would like to invite me to his churches, for those who are listening now or in the future for this video, you can contact us in Facebook, Facebook page. You can go to investigateislam.com. In there you will see our Facebook. You can contact me. Or you can contact through the website itself. And you can give me the details and we confirm that this is a legitimate invitation and I will be happy to go to your church, regardless of the location. You see, you will not be farther than the far east of Asia. I went all the way to the end of Asia. So you will not be farther than this, which means it doesn't matter really how far it is I'm willing to go. As long it is a real legitimate thing, scheduled, organized by a church, and there is real people who are waiting for real event to happen. All right? Anyway, we as a Christians, we should line up together. And as you see, the Muslims, they are working hard. You see, the thing about Muslims, they are following a very false religion, but they help each other. They sponsor each other. Like right now, if you say, I want to build a mosque, anywhere in USA, anywhere in Europe, anywhere in Australia, you will see how fast they get the fund for it. This is one of the things, you know, we have to admit that Muslims are doing better than us in this case. We have the true belief, we have a true faith. We have the true love which unite us. We are not united by hate, but yet we cannot be united together to do something good most of the time. Like, you know, go right now and mention the topic Catholic and Protestant, and you will see how Christians start throwing rocks at each other in a second. I was going to make a video, actually. I'm thinking to make it maybe next week. I was thinking to call it What If the Catholic Killed Jesus? Imagine if the Catholic is the one who killed Jesus. The funny that the Jews who killed Jesus, if you ask any Protestant, he will say to you, well, Jesus forgive them. Jesus said, forgive them, Father, they do not know what they are doing. If you ask any Catholic, what do you think about Jesus? They will say, about the Jews, he will say, well, Jesus forgive them. Okay, Jesus forgave the one who killed him, and we cannot forgive what happened 1400 years ago. What we cannot forgive what happened 1000 years ago. So we will be divided forever, and we will be throwing rocks at each other. You know what I mean? How we can be really truly Christians and we are divided too much? How we can be serving God when we are divided? How I can be a Christian who love the Messiah and I say to my brother, just because he's from different church and he have a pope or a priest, that you are not no Christian? How we can be Christians then? So we as a Christians, we have to fix our problems inside the house. And we have to unite together. We have to work together. You know, ask yourself, like just ask yourself a question. If tomorrow morning we wake up in the morning and we find there's no Catholic, there's no Protestant, there's no Orthodox, there's a Christians, do you think Islam will be happy? What do you think, guys? Do you think the Muslims will be happy for such a news? There's no more Catholic and there's no more Protestant, there's no more Orthodox, but there's only Christians who love Christ. That would be very bad news for the Muslims. So why we don't do what can be good news for the Messiah and do bad news for the devil? The bad news for the devil that we are united. The good news for the devil that we are divided. This is why you see me, I am against division, because I believe strongly that division is not for the benefit of our faith, and it's not for what Christ he wants. And actually this is very, you know, very logical, right? So we should really unite together, work together, and stop being divided. This is not what God he wants. This is not what Christ he wants. We have one church, and that is the church of Christ. It doesn't matter really. You know, for me, I'm afraid if I show you in the screen, there's some names will show. So I will try to avoid that. But let me see if I can show you part of it. Once I wanted to do a seminar, so a brother, he gave reference that's, actually I cannot go in because I am in Gmail now. If I log in, log off, I will log from Hangout, I forgot. All right, so the brother who referred me to a church, and this church is a Protestant church, the email he received and he forwarded to me, it was saying, Do he submit to his priest? This is a Protestant church. Do he submit to his priest? Do he fully submit? I was laughing really. What do you mean I fully submit to my priest? Why I need to submit to priest? What are you talking about? Who is the priest anyway? So we have a problem. We throw rocks at each other. We say we should not submit to the Pope when the other church submit to the priest. When both they have the same issue, both they have the same problem, and they cannot get over it. This is why I say, priest, they divide, unless they are good. Priest who don't want the church to be united, they are not working for God. They are working for their own business. A true priest is the one who wants the Christians to be one. And he believes that we are one. Our differentiation should not be a problem, should be actually for our good. We really need to make a new reform for our movement as a Christians. We should work better, do better, be united more. Like, you know, you see Christians are going in the road in Europe. You should join. This is your day. If you don't join today, who is going to be there tomorrow? Don't sit and watch and say, this is none of my business. Don't be scared. You know, in this earth, scared people, they have no place. If you are a coward, you have no place in this earth. You have no place even with the Messiah. Imagine the apostle of the Messiah, they go to places where nobody goes, and they know that death is waiting for them there, and they've been tortured, and they've been killed, and they've been slaughtered, and they cut their heads off, and they feed them to the animals, and still they go. And this is why they were victorious. Coward will never accomplish anything. And we are not cowards. All right? So I want you, the most important thing for me today, actually, here we gave you the way to answer Muslims to refute them, but in the same time, I have a little message for you, how we can unite our Christian sisters and brothers together to work together and forget about the name of the church they go to. That will be very beautiful. You know, I don't care really if you're a Catholic or Protestant or Orthodox. All of you are my brothers and sisters in Christ. I love you all. And I'm sure you know, when you give love, the love come back to you. Our differences is not really great. Our differences is not even bad. All of us, we worship one God. All of us, we believe in the resurrection, the salvation, the crucifixion, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. What is different? A picture, a pope? Forget about them. We have bigger value to share than a pope or a priest. We have the Messiah. We share the Messiah. We share the Word of God. We share His miracle. We share His salvation. We share His cross. We share our hope that of him coming. So what is left? So let us grow up with wisdom, not with division. Division will take you nowhere. And I'm sure if Muslims now are listening, they will be so upset of my message. And they will hope that Christians will not have the same message all over. Follow no man. You see, no man deserves to be followed. There's no pope, there's no priest, there's no Christian prince. All of us, we are sinners. I'm the one who's talking to you. Do you know how much sin I have? But do you think I'm a good guy? I'm not. So you follow a man, you are a fool. I am not perfect, so how you expect perfection from me? Why are you expecting perfection from a priest? He is just a man like you. Are you perfect? You are not. He is not. So those who they are judging at churches, saying, oh, look what this church did. Look what that church did. Look what this pope did. Look this what the priest did. Well, this is very normal to happen because those are sinners. Right? We have to be smart. We have to be really smart, otherwise the devil is waiting for us. And you know, there's many that will be happy to see us ununited. You see, some they say to me, Christian Prince, you're attacking James White. I'm not attacking James White. I'm correcting him. There's a huge difference between me. I believe he is, you know, unless he go out of the line and say Muhammad is a prophet, then he is not my brother in Christ. For me, I stand up to correct him because he deceived people by, I don't know what his purpose. I am assuming that he is just being a person who grew up in a school full of let us say, he never been exposed to the true Islam, so he have his own vision of Islam. This is why he got a wrong interpretation of it. So it's my duty to stand to correct. I'm not against him as a person. I never met him. I do not know him. Actually, I see, you know, I get happy when I see him defending the Bible. This is a great honor. But in the same time, I get so upset when he say that Islam is not ISIS, because this is a great lie. If you know it is wrong and he said he's lying, if you know it's not wrong, that is a problem too, because it means that the ignorant became a teacher. Don't teach about a topic you do not know. You see, if James White now came and argued with me about a verse in the Bible and he started telling me in Greek it says that, I don't know what to say to him because I don't speak Greek. I'm not a scholar in the Bible, so I'm not going to claim to be something. I'm not that one. So don't go and claim to be someone it is not you. Otherwise, people will laugh at you. Right? At the end of this video, I want to say thank you for those who they send donation already. I really appreciate them. Very, very kind of you. And you know, many times I said before that I have not much expectation of people to help, and that's very, you know, very normal, because as I said, you know, we are not perfect, and people, they you know, everyone have his own reason to do things. For me, I know none of you. So when you say I want to help Christian Prince, I really appreciate that, because simply you don't have to. It's a choice you make. And until now, we have donation of $300 total. Now, for sure, I was expecting different, like based on how many people they said we would help. But it's okay. At least there is people there who they are really truthful and they do what they think is good to do. So I'm happy for those. We have 14 people there who they decide to help. I appreciate them really from my heart. And the poor one who could not do it, don't think I don't appreciate you. I very appreciate the poor too, because the poor are blessed. And but if you can give, that will show that you are truthful and you are doing what you should do for God. So I want to say thank you at the end of this video, and I hope the number will grow, because our mission is big and what we have is nothing except the truth and our Lord, and this is everything actually. But you know that in this earth, I will not be speaking to you unless I have internet, and I will not have internet unless I pay for it. I will not have, you know, everything. You have to pay for everything, nothing for free. Actually, even when you die, you have to pay for your funeral. Nobody will bury you unless you pay for it, right? So if you believe really in what we do, please help us so we can help others. And that's all what I have to say. With this, I want to say thank you. God bless you. And I hope to see you soon again, maybe tomorrow in Pal Talk. I might open the room. For sure, we will open Friday. Until I see you again, I say God bless, and thank you very much.